today on Beyond 6 Seconds.
I didn't realize that, like, you don't need to know everything from the start. It's a lot of experimentation, and it's a lot of, like, just going out there and doing whatever you think is right, because there's not a correct process that you can follow. There's not a rule book that you can just say, I'm on step one, how do I get to step two?
Welcome to Beyond 6 Seconds, the podcast that goes beyond the 6-second first impression to share the extraordinary stories and achievements of everyday people. I'm your host, Carolyn Keel. On today's episode, I'm speaking with Nikhil Pampati. Nikhil is currently a high school senior at Middlesex County Academy for Science, Mathematics, and Engineering Technologies. In his free time, however, he serves as the co-founder and CFO of the national nonprofit Jobstopia, a U.S.-based professional development program he started as a high school junior in 2017. Nikhil, welcome to the podcast.
Hi, thank you so much for having me.
I'm really happy to have you here, and I'm so excited to learn more about the startup that you started while you were in high school. So tell us a little bit more about Jobstopia.
Yeah, sure. So it was actually based on my entrepreneurial passion that I gained from a summer program known as the Quarter Zero Catapult Incubator. So from there, I met a couple of other fellow entrepreneurs who were really interested in starting something to make a difference in what they felt was right and what they felt the next generation of students really needed. And we were passionate about trying to instill like a newfound sense of motivation and a newfound sense of like just what they want to do in later on in their careers. So we actually got together and we started a nonprofit, as you mentioned, known as Jobscopia. And Jobscopia's mission is really to connect students with professionals and have them be their mentors. So that way they really know what they want to do in later life. So like, for example, a lot of students may know that they want to be a lawyer later on in their career, but they don't really know the hours of research that goes into it, the hours of case studies. And oftentimes being a lawyer is just portrayed as going to court and arguing in several cases. And we really wanted to make a difference in other students' lives to really explain like what goes into different careers and what different careers entail. So by introducing them to different professionals across the country, whether it be from Fortune 500s or startup companies alike, they get a chance to really interact with the professional world. And that's something that students aren't really exposed to nowadays. Like back even in the 90s, when you had your typical job shadow career day coming to your school and having a couple parents and volunteers who talked about their career, I think that's really the root of what we were trying to bring to students, but in a more like flushed out way. So what we have our students do is either contact us for a mentorship. So they can contact us, say, hey, I want to be mentored by this kind of professional. I would really love to learn more about what they do. And then we set them up with about a 6-week mentorship where they can talk to a professional in a company, say like Google or a startup in their local area, and get to know them and get to really understand what their day-to-day is like and how their journey has propelled them to where they are today. Or they can sign up for a job shadow program, which is a little bit more formal. So this is where a group of students or a single student, if we have a small number of students in the area, we actually take them to a company and they get to tour the company for a day. For example, the other month we had a kid who wanted to tour Merck, and Merck actually set up a cool 1-day job shadow with us, and we were able to do something cool with them. And we originally were started in California, which is where the incubator was located. Mm-hmm. And we actually got multiple job shadows there, whether it be with like Intel regional offices or Apple stores. And it was just a really cool experience for these students to see like the ins and outs of a company and to really work with a professional to see what am I actually doing throughout the day if I choose to be in this field. And we always thought like, yes, there are YouTube videos to show them like what are you going to be experiencing if you go into this profession? But gaining real hands-on experience is something that students need more of nowadays, whether it be in STEM, whether it be in business, finance, the humanities, or medicine. They need more hands-on experience to really understand what they want to do later in the career. So as they're growing up in their educational path, whether it be in high school or college, they can really focus in on what they want to do and not necessarily gain like a solid foundation in like one thing, but really try to focus in on what their interests are so that they are actually like propelled and empowered when they go into the workforce.
Wow. So that sounds like an amazing opportunity for students. I'm just thinking that I probably know plenty of adults who would love to have that same type of mentoring and experiential learning about careers. Because you're right, I feel like nowadays there's so much information available because, you know, with the internet and YouTube, and you can read about anything anywhere and sort of try to imagine what it would be like to be in different professions. But really, nothing beats that one-to-one mentoring and that hands-on experience. And I think it's really valuable that you're able to provide that to students while they're still in school, while they're starting to think about, you know, what kinds of
careers they might be interested in, and just give them a realistic flavor of what it's really like to do this type of work. So that's awesome. And I think it's also cool that you got to work with an incubator over the summer and come up with this idea. And I'm curious, how did you come up with this specific idea for creating professional development opportunities and sort of career mentoring? Was that something that you had as an idea from your own experience in your mind, or how did that all come together?
So it's actually pretty funny, the origin story. So the way the incubator works is there's a set people of founders and there's a set people of agents. So free agents get matched to founders and then they go off from there. So my original founder, her name was Kaylee. She brought an idea of starting like a Wikipedia for jobs kind of thing. So like students can go on the platform and just explore like what different careers are out there. And we started to like embark on that venture idea, but we eventually realized that it would probably not be realistic to just get a database of all the jobs, and as there are probably a lot that exist already. So we decided to actually head out on the streets of San Mateo. So we literally just went up to a random person. We're like, hey, do you have a child? And they're taken aback, like, what? They're like, what are you talking about? And we're like, oh, I'm so sorry for alarming you, but we're actually just part of a set of high school students in a local incubator trying to see what customers need. And we just want to get your take on teaching students, if that's okay with you. And she was like, okay, yeah, now I can tell you. But yeah, I have two children. Why do you ask? And we told her, like, we're actually seeking to see how we can get students more interested in careers early on and get them focused in life to see like what they want to do so they can pick a specific college or pick a specific path to like try to get that career. And she said, yeah, well, I definitely have two children. They're really interested in medicine. And right now they're trying to shadow hospitals and doctors to try to see what they want to do. And we asked her, like, how difficult is that shadowing process? How are you able to arrange that with the doctor? And she said, well, there's no formal programs that exist with shadowing doctors. Like, there are some programs where you can, like, sign up and try to get, like, a tour of multiple hospitals. But as for cold calling and cold emailing doctors and getting shadowing opportunities, it's really difficult to come by. And then that was like a light bulb moment for us. We really were like, oh, that's a real need that people need. And from there, we went back to the incubator. Actually, we talked to a couple more people. Some were less responsive, some were more responsive. And they all gave the general gist that their kids would want something more hands-on. And from there, we realized that rather than having a database to inform students about all the jobs that exist, why don't we have a database of professionals who can actually teach these students what their jobs are all about? So we started with the medical profession. We were like, oh my God, there's so many more opportunities in every other field as well. Why just limit ourselves to medical companies or a pharmaceutical company? So we cold called like 100 companies that day, just trying to like sprint and trying to get as many companies as we can get on board. And obviously that was our first day and we were rookies in call and cold calling. So I think we got about one company in response, actually like listening to our phone call, and they heard out our idea, and they were actually a music studio, and the music studio was like, oh, this is a great idea. So we set up a kid named Brent, and Brent actually he actually did a one-day job shadow there, and he really got to explore the like what happens in a record label company, what happens in a recording studio, and what different jobs there are in that kind of business. And it's not just about being a producer, it's not just about being a musician, but there's a lot of back-end work that takes experience and takes knowledge and takes like a degree in studying and actually exploring the field. So your two options aren't just going to be being a musician or being a producer if you go into the music industry. And we had a great success with Brent. We like loved his feedback, and we actually used him our first pitch to investors on demo day for the incubator. So his was a good success story, and we like to keep in touch with some of our students, and we know Brent's doing really good. He pursued a couple of internships, and he's trying to go into college for something in the music industry. So that's a real good story right there. But yeah, so after just talking with a couple of these random people on the streets, we expanded from there. We started contacting bigger companies to see if they would love to get some professionals on board. And rather than going from a top-down process, we try to get more employees from a company and eventually approaching the company saying, hey, a lot of your employers are interested in what we're doing. I was wondering if you would want to partner with us on like a bigger scale. So just contacting employees who go to these hackathons as mentors, who go to other professional networking conferences for young students who are really interested in the next generation. We try to go to those conferences and those hackathons to get them interested, and we get a huge response usually because these professionals are amazing in the fact that they love working with students. And I think that just goes to show how much opportunity there is for students. It's just about facilitating that process so that students are like empowered to do this by themselves. And we're just trying to act like a launching platform to actually get them motivated and get them sparked so they know what to do. And they're one day, hopefully, they'll be able to do this in the future with another student.
Yeah. And that's really interesting, the whole evolution of how you reached out. You know, you start literally with the customer needs out on the street and then cold calling companies that you think might be interested in participating. And then I think it really makes a lot of sense to find, you know, not just the, I don't know if it's the HR departments or sort of the official department that might work with a program like this, but to also find those employees who are actively involved already with helping students through like hackathons and other opportunities. That's, I can totally see how that would help you expand your base of your corporate clients. And then how do you get your students, how do they sign up? Is it through school or how do you connect with them?
Yeah, sure. So we started off, as I said, in California, San Mateo, like that area. And we had like people in my team were already from the California area. So they just reached out to their friends and they said, hey, spread the word, try to get some students who are interested. And surprisingly, we had like a small amount of response. We thought it would catch fire more quickly, but then we just posted our website online and we saw that like our name had a unique search value. Like whenever people searched up like job opportunities for high school students or job shadowing opportunities, we actually popped up a lot. So another surprising thing was we actually had a lot of organic people come in. We didn't like do any marketing for them. We had a lot of people come in from different states across the country. And it was interesting to see how many people just found us online and without even having word of mouth marketing. And it was really interesting to see that. But for finding people who are more in our area, so we launched in New Jersey about a year ago. Mm-hmm. And what I've been able to do is I know a lot of, like, I go to a school, as you said, Middlesex County Academy, which has students from multiple districts. So I reached out to each student in my grade who would be from like a separate district in the Middlesex County area. And we had them contact their origin school. Like, for example, I'm from Monroe Township. So I would contact my Monroe Township High School and I would contact like a student that I knew from the Monroe Township High School and he would spread the word within his school. So we were actually able to like, you know, branch out that way. Like a lot of people referring to one person and then they would tell another person and you know how word of mouth is. It just gets huge. So we got a lot of students just from word of mouth, going to these hackathons, as I said, marketing it there. And we saw that like once we got the wheel rolling, it kind of just took off by itself. More students get more and more interested and, you know, it just starts catching fire and people are like, hey, what program did you do? You actually got to meet this cool new employee and got to have this mentor. And they were like, oh, I did Jobscopia. And that eventually caught on and more students signed up. So I definitely think that it took some work in the beginning trying to get these students because they needed to be exposed as to what opportunity there was for them. Yeah. I think once it started catching fire, I think that's really when we had to focus more on getting professionals on board rather than the students.
I see. And so what kind of industries or fields are represented now? I know you started with the medical field and pharmaceutical, but now what other types of industries do you have for the employers?
Yeah, it's a great question. So originally we wanted to start off by going into every single industry, but we realized that as a small startup, we realized that we needed to start small and scale bigger once we started to get more students and more professionals. So right now we're operating in three industries, the music industry, because we started off with right. Brent and we wanted to keep that going. Then we are also in the medical pharmaceutical industry as well as the tech industry because we realize that there are a lot of jobs that are being unclaimed in the tech industry each year. And if we got students interested early, they might want to pursue computer science major or cybersecurity major later on in college. So those STEM fields we really want to target. And we've been branching out in those industries. And there's also a lot of tech startups in New York City and New Jersey. And we really wanted to take advantage of those tech startups because a lot of those startups are started by young entrepreneurs themselves. And they realize that like the next generation is a really big thing. And they really want to give back and try to teach students who they were once, like they were once in their place. So they realize that if they had this opportunity, they would jump at it and they would take it themselves. So these young entrepreneurs love giving back and love, you know, actually helping these students out. So the tech industry is one of the biggest opportunities for us.
Yeah, I could see that. And, you know, especially the tech industry just is changing so rapidly. So I think it's important for students to get exposed early to what those opportunities are because it's just constantly changing. And I can imagine every year there's just new types of opportunities, particularly in tech. So it's great to have that hands-on experience.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. So what is the program actually structured like? Is it like a one-day job shadow? Do you have a specific program that people have to follow? Or is it more sort of making those connections with employers and students?
Yeah, so there's, like I mentioned, there's two programs. So the first one is just like more of a structured thing where they get to see a one-day job shadow of like what the company is about and what are the ins and outs, and they get like a tour. The other one's more of like a six-week mentorship process where they actually get to check in with the mentor, talk about their life experiences, maybe talk about the students' life experiences and try to see how they connect, and then try to see like what they can do in their own position right now, the students, I mean, like what they can do in the position they are in right now to try to like copy the mentor or like emulate the mentor and try to see if they can get to their position one day. But we recognized that for the STEM fields more, we wanted to start early, and we realized that like maybe the high school level was even too late of a starting point. So we wanted to target middle school students. And that's what I've been trying to do with another program I started. It was known as the Junior Achievement Company Program. Mm-hmm. So what this basically does is we go into middle schools and high schools and we try to get them interested in entrepreneurship and how tech can really relate with entrepreneurship. And I've been working with Junior Achievement for the past 2 years, I believe. And what we've been trying to do is integrate entrepreneurship with a new initiative we started called Next Gen Tech Series, which is basically a series of hackathons and crack the code events with middle school students and high school students to try to get them to see the link between entrepreneurship and technology and try to see how if you have a firm grasp of technology and STEM, you can actually change the world in a lot of places if you also have a strong foundation in entrepreneurship, because those two go hand in hand. Mm-hmm. You make the product and you try to get it to market. So we've been really trying to integrate these two different fields and try to develop them and market them to the next generations of students, whether it be high school students, middle school students. And I've been trying to do that through Junior Achievement and Jobscopia.
Wow. That's amazing. So, you know, you're the co-founder, CFO of Jobscopia. You're now working also on this, the JA Company program, and you're also still in high school. So I have got to ask, like, how do you balance going to high school on a daily basis and running a startup and all these other programs?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So actually, I focus most of my time on the weekends on doing these other activities. Obviously, the week can get pretty busy. So the weekends are a great time for any entrepreneur who has a job or who has school, who has college. It's a great opportunity to take advantage of all that extra free time and really like get some work done. Obviously, there are like emails sent back and forth and calls going on throughout the week, but I find that those don't take much of my time. Like those are more of the communication and logistical work, but the real groundwork is laid on those weekends that everyone loves. So, you know, school can be hard, obviously, but it's always good when you have passion for what you're doing. I'm obviously trying to get students interested and actually try to make a difference. So it's really surprising what passion can do for you in that aspect.
Absolutely. Yeah. So you wind up devoting a good part of your free time outside of school. And I guess say if you have the passion for it, you know, it makes it easier. It definitely gives you the continued motivation to continue growing the businesses. Right. Absolutely.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Yeah. So tell me a little bit about the biggest challenge you faced in launching or running Jobscopia, and how do you either address or kind of work through it?
I definitely say the biggest challenge with starting a nonprofit or any startups would just be like the initial stages. Like many young entrepreneurs, they don't realize that like you don't need to know everything. Like when I started this out, right, I was like, oh, I have to do so much research on like how to cold call, how to find professionals, how to like access corporate leaders and pierce that corporate veil just to see like how can I get into that system. But I didn't realize that like you don't need to know everything from the start. It's a lot of experimentation and it's a lot of like just going out there and doing whatever you think is right, because there's not a correct process that you can follow. There's not a rule book that you can just say, I'm on step one, how do I get to step two? Because a lot of it is just saying like, what can I do next to achieve my goal? And what do I think? It's all about what you think. It's all about like, what do you think? And your team, obviously, what your team thinks is the next best move. Because as an entrepreneur, you really don't have a set path that you can follow. And I think that's the real magic of entrepreneurship. It's just about doing what you can and doing what you think is right to like take the next step. For example, when I went to the incubator, I had no idea what my end goal was. Like I didn't even know what I wanted to do. I just knew I wanted to try something new. And I think that's really the fundamentals of any entrepreneur. They just want to try something new and try to make a difference. And I think that's the biggest advice anyone can give. Just try to be different and try to be something that you want to be and something that you think you can achieve. And I know like that might not be the best like advice for someone saying like, what do I do? Like, mm-hmm. obviously like saying like, oh, just do what you can is not a big help logistically, but I think that's the biggest and most honest answer anyone can give. Like when I started as my journey in entrepreneur, I had no idea what I was doing. Like I didn't even know who to contact. I didn't know can I really send an email to like this big company, like, and will they even respond? And the answer is yes, they might not. But at the same time, if you spark their interest and if you actually get them like, hey, this is a cool idea, then they'll respond no matter what. People will listen to your ideas as long as you developed it, and as long as you are believe in it and are passionate about it, they will listen to your ideas. And that's exactly what I'm trying to communicate all this time. And in the beginning, I started as a novice entrepreneur, and that's like anyone, right? And then at the end, the Quarter Zero company actually called me back to mentor other entrepreneurs because of my journey. And I think that really speaks to like anyone can do this. Like, it's not something that I have special, or it's not something that anyone else has special. It's just about having that passion to like chase what you believe in. And eventually people will recognize that and try to help you along the way. So like in the summer of 2018, I really believed in some new ideas that were being introduced into the next incubator for Catapult. So they contacted me and they said, if you want, you could be a mentor. And I jumped on that opportunity. I really love working with other entrepreneurs. It's cool because it's not just me mentoring them, it's them mentoring me. Mm-hmm. You're never done learning. You're always learning from others and you're always seeing what new ideas other people can bring. So it was a really great opportunity for mentorship, both me mentoring them and them mentoring me. And there were some really cool ideas produced out of that incubator. And I was happy to work with those teams. Some ventures even being featured on Fox Business and more. And it was really cool to see like how many ideas people can produce and just what new innovative ideas people are thinking about. So I think it's just about being more creative and it's just about doing what you believe in that will get you to your end goal.
Yeah, that's amazing and really great advice. You know, you do your research and, you know, you can listen to advice, but the important part is just going out and doing things. And it is amazing that sometimes people think like, I don't know if I can I send an email to a company? Like, I don't think that's unique to your experience. I've heard other people say that. And, you know, like, it's great that you actually did and you learn from what works. And, you know, not everybody responds and not everybody is on board right away, but you just need those few couple people to start out. And like you said, it's really just about trying things, learning from what you've tried, and just always being open to being a lifelong learner. And it sounds like you're really getting some really great experiences in entrepreneurship and running a nonprofit and developing your programs along the way too.
Yeah, definitely. And I like, even if you're not like a, let's say an entrepreneur and you don't want to like start something on your own, it's always great just to learn how that process works. So like, if you're really interested, you can just go and join a startup. There's, like I said, there's so many startups in New York City. There's so many new innovative ideas being put out there on the market that are so small that people are not taking notice. But if you actually go and do the research as to like what field you're interested in, what startups exist, I'm sure like they'll be happy to like work with you. Just reach out to them, send them a cold email, and they'll be really happy to work with someone your age because they're young themselves and they want to get more people on board. And as long as you reach out to them and say, hey, I'm interested in your new startup, and you can work with them to see, like, as in a startup, you have a lot of autonomy, you have a lot of freedom to take multiple roles. So even if you're, what if your role is an intern, you might be doing stuff that a CEO or a CFO does. So if you reach out to these startups and actually contact them and be passionate and say, I really want to help, then they'll give you a big role and they'll actually like let you understand and let you get that experience as to how they started and how you can start your own company if you choose to one day. So that's a really great opportunity as well.
Oh, good. Yeah, good advice to look for startups because, yeah, a lot of times you wind up wearing many hats. So it's a great opportunity to learn different parts of the business. Absolutely. Wow. So, you know, looking forward, what are your goals for Jobstopia? Is it something that you're going to continue to grow after you graduate from high school or continue to evolve? What does that look like?
Yeah, definitely. So there are two main goals that I have for Jobstopia. So first off, in college, there are many professional organizations that students can join that actually connect them with professionals because a lot of those professionals are in companies that do recruiting processes right on campuses. So I definitely want to take advantage of those student organizations and trying to leverage them to actually get more professionals on board to the Jobstopia. And my second goal is we started off as a high school student-run program, and I think we definitely want to continue that way. Whereas I move on, I'm obviously going to keep on track on this work and actually still be hands-on with the process and still be involved in the company. But I definitely want new leadership and new young blood in high school entrepreneurs and high school seniors and juniors to come on board and actually start leading this Jobstopia as well. We want it to continue to be high school run because only other high schoolers can really understand what's going on with other high schoolers. You know what I mean? So it's more about getting that like connection with from student to student rather than having a professional manage all these students, because only students can understand each other. And I think if we have students running these programs, then it's going to be best to continue. So I'll definitely stay on board in college, but I would love to have new high school leaders.
Fantastic. Yeah, absolutely great to continue to bring leaders from high school into this business, because it's, of course, an opportunity for them to get direct exposure to running a business and being entrepreneurial with a real life case working through Jobstopia. Absolutely. Wow. So, Nikhil, thank you so much for telling us all about Jobstopia and what inspired you to start it and what your experiences have been with it so far. How can people get in touch with you if they want to learn more about Jobstopia?
Yeah, sure. So you can contact me on Facebook, Nikhil Hampati. If you search me up, I'll be there. I respond to everyone because we have students contacting us all the time. So just feel free to shoot me a text on Messenger, or you can just go on the website, jobscopia.com, and shoot us an email there and we'll be happy to respond. So yeah, we're really accessible. And if you ever have any questions, you can always contact us.
Awesome. Yeah. And I'll put those links in the show notes of the podcast so people can find them there too.
Okay. Awesome. Thank you so much.
Cool. So, you know, as we close out, is there anything else that you'd like our listeners to know or anything else that they can help or support you with?
Yeah. So if you're a student looking to participate in the program, like I said, just reach out to us. And if you're a student who's interested in entrepreneurship, my biggest piece of advice is just go for it. Like a year ago, I thought I couldn't do any of this. And here I am today. And like, I'm still learning in my process as well. Like I haven't reached the mark I want to reach yet, but it's just about keep going and keep hustling and keep on the entrepreneurial grind. So if you ever think that you can't start a company or can't start a nonprofit, like you're kidding yourself, anyone can do it. Just about having the passion and just going for it.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Nikhil. This is great.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for listening to Beyond 6 Seconds. Please help us spread the word about this podcast. Share it with a friend. Give us a shout out on your social media or write a review on Apple Podcasts or your favorite podcast player. You can find all of our episodes on our website, www.beyond6seconds.com. Until next time.